So not too long ago, we looked at, was that last week? We looked at two terms at once. I don't even remember. I think it was. No, it wasn't. I'm sorry. It was patient. It was gentle and brawler we looked at. So last 2 weeks ago, we looked at two terms at once. Today, we're going to look at two verses at once. How about that? Huh? We are making some serious progress. I know somebody's been praying for me, right? Please, God, get Brother Jamie through this section. No, but we're just taking our time and just trying to follow the leadership of the Lord, and we don't want to go too quickly over anything. We just want to get all that God would have us to see in this particular passage. We're on lesson 22 of Church Offices and number 40 regarding church order. So 1 Timothy 3, and we are now in verse number 4. We want to talk about the state of this man. We understand something as we get into this next section here, that this is not something we're just observing as these men are gathered among the people of God. We've got to look at his relationships that are outside of the assembly as well. And so that includes both home and just in the world in general. And we're going to see that as we continue on in this passage. But this morning, we're going to focus specifically on the home. And let's see what it has to say here regarding the qualifications of a bishop or an elder or pastor, beginning in verse number 4. He is to be a man, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? So I want to make this important point, because I don't think some people understand this. An elder's family, a pastor's family life, is not a hindrance to the ministry. It is training ground for the ministry, okay? The pastor's home life is training ground. The duties of family are not in opposition, in the sense that he is being trained and taught by the Lord in those responsibilities within the family to be able to pastor a church. That's what this verse is telling us. It starts here at the home, and if this man can't handle himself and handle his home properly, he is not fit to lead in the church, right? So that's going to be how we understand that he can lead in the church. It is if he is leading effectively in his home. The way that he cares for his family is a reflection of how he will care for the church. Those two things go together. Training ground for the pastor. I have gotten the impression from some people that that is not the case, that when it comes to a pastor's home life, you know, the verse we ought to quote is, you got to forsake father and mother and son and daughter and wife and all these things, and, you know, hate all of these, because God's most important and this responsibility here is most important, and you just abandon your family. That's not biblical, right? That is not biblical. How he loves and cares for his family is an evidence of how he will love and care for the church. That passage there, it ends up saying, and he hates even his own life. And so, yes, God is the priority. God is the great love in every believer's life, right? And if you don't walk in accordance with God, you and I can't walk together, right? Except to be agreed, they can't walk together. But his family life and how he handles that family life and all the struggles and the difficulties that arise as a result of that is preparing him for how to handle those things as they occur in the church. He's being taught how to love. He's being taught how to handle difficult situations there in the family. Look a little bit further in 1 Timothy 5 and in verse number 8, and listen to this verse. Just a little later, what Paul writes concerning dealing with things in a man's own house. 1 Timothy 5 and verse number 8. But if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. All right? So a man that won't care for his own, and he says, especially those of his own house. The margin here reads kindred. It's talking about his individual household. A man that won't do that, he is worse than an infidel. The word infidel there is basically unbeliever. That's the way some translations read it. It means one that has no faith. He's worse than one who has no faith. Because he has claimed the name of Jesus Christ, but he's denied Christ in his actions as he failed to care for his own house. He is worse than an infidel. I want you to see something in John chapter 19. I want you to see the example of our Lord regarding this. Jesus Christ dying on a cross, right? Anybody know how many phrases Christ uttered as he was on the cross? How many statements he made? How many, brother?
Seven.
Seven, right? Seven statements while he's on the cross. Chose his words very carefully, right? These are the handful of things that are going to be said that I want to make sure you know as I'm dying upon this cross. These are words that I want to leave with you. Do you know one of the things he leaves with us is teaching about this very thing? Teaching concerning a man caring for his own. Listen to this in John 19 and verse number 26. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. And when he saw his mother, it's as if his heart is moved with love and care and compassion for her when his eyes fall upon her. And he says, I got to say this from the cross. I'm here dying for your sins right now, but it's critical that I make this statement and that I care for my own in this hour. Do you see the type of sacrificial love that Jesus Christ had for his earthly family, for his natural mother, who we know also was his spiritual sister, right? Was his spiritual daughter. And it says he looks upon her and he has compassion upon her. And he says, Woman, behold thy son. Then he saith to the disciple, Behold thy mother. Unless we wonder what this is all about, unless we don't really follow this or understand this, we know that John knew exactly what that meant. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. John says, this means he would have me to care for her. And he takes her into his home from that point on and cares for his earthly mother. Christ literally cared for his family upon the earth. He thought this teaching was so important that making only seven brief statements on the cross, he would include this teaching in it. How about that? It's pretty powerful, isn't it? That's the example that we have from our Lord. So if a man doesn't love and care for his family, if a man is not loving and caring for his wife and kids like God does for his, then he's not fit for the ministry. This is training ground. How does he behave in his family? How does he care for his own? If he won't love and care for them, he will not care for the church properly. That's what our text says. Those two things go together. Our love should be so strong for these that the strength of God's love for his own is revealed. How does God describe his relationship with the church, with his people? As a father to his children, right? As a husband to his wife. He speaks of these relationship in family terms. And so that's what family life has to reveal. We are to reflect the Lord in all that we say and do and think. Ministry, proper ministry, does not abandon the family. Brother Gene's talked about this before with some of the Southern Baptist churches he was in, and it was like they had you busy doing stuff all the time. And there was no time to spend with your family because God first and you got to do all of this. But wait a minute. Part of my responsibility as a Christian is toward my family. I'm to love and care for my own. So those things should not be in opposition to one another. Ministry, proper ministry, does not abandon family. A faithful minister loves and cares for them like God loves and cares for his own. And God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you, church. It is here in the family that a man is first exercised and learns to love selflessly. This is the training ground for that. How are you going to do that in the church? That's learned first in a man's family as God saves him and he learns to die to himself. Man, it's, oftentimes that's the hardest place to do that, right? The hardest place to die to self and to deal with being mistreated and to receive evil for your love is in the family. We can put up with a lot from a lot of people, but when it happens right there with someone close to us in the home, it seems like it's the hardest place to do that. You know it's true, right? You learn to love selflessly there. That's where you're trained and exercised in that. We first begin to lay down our life for our friends, Jesus, which Jesus said is the greatest love. You first learn to do that here. It's like one brother said, I think he heard this somewhere, husbands love your wives, can't do that. Well, lay down your life for your friend. She's your friend too. Well, you don't know who this woman. Okay, well, love your neighbor as yourself. She's all those things, right? It's there in the household that these things first come into play. And where we're exercised and trained in these things, it is here that our passion and burden for souls is first manifested. I remember a man, a pastor, one time saying, he had been for years in the ministry, and he was so, the Lord had begun to show the doctrines of grace to him, and he began to understand predestination and election. And we've talked about this before, how there seems to be often a pattern in that men's hearts become hard as they hear that. And it's almost that Pharisaical attitude, or is it Pharisaical? I'm not sure the right way to say that. But it's we are God's chosen people, and you're not. Right? And so they despised the Samaritans and they despised the Gentiles because they weren't the chosen people of God. And I remember him one time preaching and weeping and saying, you know, it never occurred to me to pray for my lost son. How awful is that? They had become so hardened in those things, and it's almost like that was expected. You're supposed to be hard toward these now. No, that's not what the scripture teaches. Your heart ought to break for these souls. Paul said, I have such a burden for my kinsmen after the flesh that I could wish myself accursed. It is there that burden for lost souls is first manifested there in the family. Look at Genesis 18. Look at God's record of Abraham. Genesis chapter 18. And I'll remind you again, as I've reminded you in all these things, we're not just talking about pastors. Pastors are exemplary in these things. The men that are fit for the ministry should be exemplary in these things, but this applies to all of the church. They're giving you an example to follow. And in Genesis 18 and in verse number 19, God says regarding Abraham, He says, God's saying, you know, should I hide this thing from Abraham that I'm going to do in verse number 17? And he says in verse 19, for I know him. And this is what I know about Abraham, that he will command his children and his household after him, that and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. Abraham is going to care for his own. Abraham is going to teach his children the right way. Abraham's going to live the right way before them. He's going to be concerned for their souls, and he's going to labor and teach them the truth. It's not going to be like when they brought the little children to Christ and the disciples are like, don't bother the master with these little vermin, right? No, bring the little children to me, Christ says. And he took them up in his arms. There's a care and there's a love. They're not a bother. They're not a trouble. Abraham will take the time to teach his children. It's interesting how some translations read in this, and I'm going to read the New King James, but there are others that read this way, and I want you to hear what this translation suggests. It says, for I have known him. concerning Abraham. I have known him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they keep the way of the Lord. In other words, the idea is that God works this in his servants. The point is, this is just normal Christian behavior, right? If you know God, you care for these of your household and you want to teach them the truth and you want to instruct them in the way that is right. Train up a child in the way that he should go. It's your job, parents. It's your responsibility to guide those children in the truth and not only say it with your lips, but live it before them. That is normal Christian behavior, to be burdened for the souls in your household and to teach them the right way. To teach them the right way. Now, go to Titus 1. Be turning to Titus 1. Our text, what did our text say? Our text said this man is to rule his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. And the King James says gravity and subjection with all gravity. Now, we've already dealt with this man's relationship with his wife. We looked at that back many, many weeks ago when we saw that he was to be the husband of one wife. We told you that some render that one wife's husband. So this man's faithfulness, dedication, and love for her, for his wife, for her well-being is a reflection of how he will love and care for the church. Those two go together. So we saw the marriage relationship early on in this, and we saw his responsibility, his devotion to her. We'll tell you how devoted he will be to the church of Jesus Christ. But now we're going to consider his relationship with his children. And so he must rule his own house well, it says. That word well is the word that's it comes from the word that's translated good in most places. So, in other words, he does a good job providing over his house, and this is evidenced, it says, in the latter part of the verse, this is evidenced by children that are in subjection to him with all gravity. In other words, he's got children that obey. They're in subjection to their father. Children that obey and who revere him. That word gravity there comes, if you take it back to the root, it's the root word there is worship. Now, we're not saying that those kids worship their father. That's not what we mean. Don't worship me, right? The angel said, worship God. When they would fall down before Paul, you know, as he was out ministering in the various places, no, don't do, the worship's reserved only for God. So we're not saying that. But what this word carries with it, it's not the word worship. I'm just telling you that's the root when you trace it back. But what this carries with it is they revere. There is reverence when they deal with their father. They respect him, in other words. His children respect him. They are in subjection, they obey, and they respect him. In other words, they don't just obey because they're scared for their lives. Now, by the way, that's appropriate at times, okay? Sometimes children should obey because they fear for their lives. That's appropriate. All right, I don't want to take that away. But also because they respect him. Because they respect their father. And you know why they respect him? They respect him because he does what he teaches them. He lives what he teaches them. I've seen kids so many times that rebel and despise what their parents taught. And you know why? You know what their excuse is? They're doing the same thing they're teaching me not to do. What right do they have to tell me to not do that when they're doing the very thing? So these kids obey not just because they're scared, but they obey because this is a man who lives what he teaches. They know he loves them. They know he is sincere in his concern for them. Look at Titus 1. Titus 1, verse number 6. This is an important enough aspect that this is one of those characteristics that are repeated over in the Titus account in the responsibilities for a pastor. And in Titus chapter 1 and verse number 6, it says that if any man be blameless, the husband of one wife, here, you know, the family life is all connected together, the husband of one wife, his relationship to his wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. Now, I want to clear something up in case there's any misconception here. Some translations, I think it was the ESV that I was looking at, translate this word faithful here, takes that to mean they've got to be believers. I don't know if I know any pastors that could stay in the ministry if that was the requirement. And I know that's not any reason to abandon the Word of God just because that's the common practice, but I'm just saying, you often see men in the ministry and their children are lost. That's not what this word means here. Faithful does not mean unbeliever in this context. Look the word up. Don't take my word for it. You're going to find it many times in the New Testament. And sometimes when he refers to the faithful, that's exactly who he's talking about in the context of that verse. He's talking about the church. But that's not the only way that this word is used. And I'll show it to you again just down a few verses in verse number 9. Exhort servants to be obedient unto their... Wait a minute. That's not right. I'm in chapter 2. Verse number 9. Holding fast the what kind of word? The faithful word. That's the same word that we have earlier in the text. Here, faithful means the trustworthy word. The word that you can depend on. The true word. Okay? So, in other words, these children are trustworthy. He's got children that are dependable. This word faithful here speaks of morality, not of salvation. There is a level of morality that is expected for these kids, and they're going to deal with dad, right, if they don't walk in this. That's what this is talking about. He's got faithful children, and the end of the verse expands really upon what that word faithful means. The rest of the verse explains it. And how are they faithful? Well, they are not accused of riot or unruly. That word riot there, it's akin to that word, regarding the prodigal when he wasted his spending on riotous living. You remember that? The word riot here is the same word excess when it says, be not drunk with wine, but be filled. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess. So his children are not living an excessive, riotous lifestyle. He would not allow that. He would not tolerate that, right? And they are not unruly. That word's translated disobedient in 1 Timothy. So they are in subjection to him. They are submitting to him. Does he keep his children in subjection? In submission? Does he not tolerate riotous behavior at any age as they're there in his house? They are morally sound while they are at home. Now, I don't hold men accountable for this once their kids leave home. Once they're outside that domain of the parents' control, that's between them and the Lord, right? But while they're at home and the parents have that control, they exercise that authority and demand this of their children. This is the general behavior as they live at home. I want to tell you something that I'm tired of hearing. I'm tired of hearing parents act like that they have no control over their kids running wild. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? It's your responsibility to do something. It's your responsibility to make those kids obey. Oh, and I want to say this. It's not grandma and granddaddy's responsibility. I'm tired of seeing that. Parents, it's your responsibility to make those kids mind. You have a responsibility from God to wear their little tails out if they're not obeying. And you better start it while you're young or your battle's going to be harder as they get older. You have a responsibility to do that. The Bible says if someone won't chasten their child, they don't love their child. A loving parent applies the rod. Now, we got challenges in our day and age concerning that, right? I don't know all the particulars, but I know there's a guy in the NFL right now that's under scrutiny because he spanked his kid with a switch, as I understand it. The world is coming against that, but you have a responsibility to train up your child in the way he should go. Oh, well, what are we going to do? You know what? That was Eli's attitude concerning his sons. Look at it. We're running out of time. But when you got some time, look at 1 Samuel 3 in verse number 13. And God said they were doing wrong, Eli. You were in a position to do something about it. You were the high priest. You should have dealt with that. And you did not. And so this judgment is coming upon them and upon this people because you didn't do what you should have done as a parent. You have a responsibility to do that. Look at Joshua 24:15. Joshua 24:15. I love how dogmatic Joshua is in this statement right here. And he says this. Parents, it's no one else's job to train your kids in the way that they should go. That's your responsibility. Joshua says this in 24 and verse number 15. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But I want to tell you something that me and my house are going to do. You notice he doesn't just say me, right? You guys take care of your own house. That's not my responsibility, all right? You guys decide what you're going to do. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Well, you know, I got a teenager now and he doesn't want to go to church. You better make him. He better be there when the Word of God is. You better care enough for his soul to fight that battle, right? If you're here under my roof, son, you're going to go to church with us. You're going to hear the gospel proclaimed. Now, often this responsibility, yes, it manifests itself in discipline, in chastisement. But you know what? That's not primarily how you know if this man is fit for ministry. Does he love his family? Does he love his family? Because you see, that's why God chastens. God chastens the son that he loves. That's what Scripture says. We're out of time. Hebrews 12:6. That says that's the motivation for God chastening his children. Because he loves them. We don't know our Heavenly Father only as a disciplinarian, do we? Is that the only relationship we have with our Heavenly Father? No. And neither should that be the only relationship that this man's kids have with him, right? It's a relationship of love. He disciplines because he loves. We're out of time. I wanted to take you to Galatians 4:19 and 1 John 2:1. And there, look up the phrase. There are six other places that John uses this in 1 John. Paul refers to the Galatians church. He says, "My little children, of whom I travail again." I'm travailing in labor for you guys. He refers to them as my little children. Seven times, John says in 1 John, my little children. That's how he addresses the church. As a father to his children. There's the relationship. You see how this man's relationship at home with his children is a reflection of how he will relate to the church. You know where they got that kind of language from? That's exactly how Christ addresses his disciples after Judas is gone in John 13 and verse number 33. My little children. Isn't that good? That's the example that our Lord has set for us. As a father pitieth his children. What's the next phrase? So the Lord. So the Lord. I want to close with this. Listen to this. Parents, how are you to love and care for your own? Listen to this. The way that God loves and cares for his. What shall we say then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. If you're going to love those kids, if you're going to love that wife, husband, as you ought to, wife, if you're going to love your husband the way that you ought to, it's going to require sacrifice. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Parents, love your kids like that. Amen.